Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. After the successful Ghazwa of Al-Abwa, which took place in the month of Safar in the second year of the Hijrah, and I say successful because that's what it was. For success is not judged by material possessions and the tangible commodities that this world has to offer. Rather, the scale upon which success is weighed is based on the adherence to the deen and the fulfillment of one's duties to Allah. For we are tasked only with carrying out the duties entrusted to us, and it is Allah that brings it to fruition, in the way that Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal knows in His infinite wisdom. And if we were to take one point home from this, it is that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, together with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, fulfilled the command of Allah simply by marching out in jihad, even if no battle took place. And this action of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum had its own benefits, which itself were immediately noticeable. Allah tells us about one such benefit in the Quran when Allah says, وَأَعِدُّوا لَهُمْ مَسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَمِنْ رِبَاطِ الْخَيْلِ تُرْهِبُونَ بِهِ عَدُوَ اللَّهِ وَعَدُوَكُمْ وَآخَرِينَ مِنْ دُونِهِمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَهُمُ اللَّهُ يَعْلَمُهُمْ. And prepare against them whatever you are able to of power and of the steeds of war, by which you may terrify the enemy of Allah and your enemy, and others besides them whom you do not know, but whom Allah knows. Now, even though the Sahaba radiallahu anhum may not have been aware of it, these continuous raids that they were doing was playing havoc on the nerves of the mushrikeen. Because the mushrikeen were in a state of constant fear, terror, fearing for their lives and their goods, not knowing when and where the Muslims would strike again. So the mushrikeen wasted no time in trying whatever they could to thwart the Muslims from reaching their caravans. They changed their routes, they changed their timings, they employed spies and lookouts to be able to get information to them as soon as possible. And they even had fully armed soldiers travel with every shipment of goods. But while the mushrikeen were busy doing their things, the Muslims were busy making their own preparations as well. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam returned to Medina from Al-Abwa at round about the middle of Safar in the second year after Hijrah. And in the very next month, the month of Rabi'ul Awwal, without easing up or giving the kuffar any peace of mind or any space to breathe, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam set out again to attack the caravan of the Quraysh. This time, the interception point was at a place called Buwaat. Buwaat is the name of a mountain from the mountains of Juhayna. It is near to modern-day Yambu. About 230 kilometers outside of Medina is where this interception point was set. Now, this caravan of the mushrikeen was a big and an important one. It was coming all the way from Sham, and it was so important that one of the heads of Kufr at the time, Umayyah ibn Khalaf, personally accompanied the caravan together with 100 men strong from the Quraysh. The amount of goods being transported was no small amount either, as this caravan consisted of 2,500 camels laden with their goods. The spirit of the Muslims were soaring, because they were being led out once more by the Rasul of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So more Sahaba radiallahu anhum rushed forward to be part of this raiding party. Because once again, this was not a pre-planned battle, so not everyone was required to go out. Others had to remain behind to see to the running of the Islamic State in Medina. This time, the Sahabi that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam entrusted the safety of the Muslims as well as the city of Medina to was a Sahabi by the name of Hadrat As-Sa'ib ibn Uthman ibn Mad'un radiyallahu anhu, the son of the great Sahabi Hadrat Uthman ibn Mad'un radiyallahu anhu, who was one of the Sabiqoon as-Sabiqoon, those early Sahaba that accepted Islam. Other historians mention that the Sahabi put in charge was actually this Sahabi's uncle, Hadrat As-Sa'ib ibn Mad'un radiyallahu anhu, the brother of Hadrat Uthman ibn Mad'un, because both the uncle and the nephew had the same name. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam set out at the head of this small army, and the flag bearer on this day, carrying the white flag, the liwa of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was the young uncle and archer of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Hadrat Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqas radiyallahu anhu, and this contingent of Muslims were comprised of 200 strong. So the Muslims set out, heading for the spot on the road that the caravans would have to pass. However, the scouts that the mushrikeen had employed saw the movement of the Muslims and knew what was coming. So they rushed off with the news to the Quraysh, and word was sent to the caravan warning them of the impending ambush awaiting them. Now Umayyah ibn Khalaf was a kafir oppressor who fancied himself a brave strong man. But hearing that the Muslims were going to intercept them, his heart shrunk. Despite the fact that he was accompanied by soldiers whose purpose was there to defend the caravan, and that they would be facing Muslims that did not have a fraction of the equipment and weaponry that they themselves had. But none of this was enough to allay the terror that his heart felt at the possibility that they would lose to the Muslims, not only their goods, but their lives too. So they immediately made the decision to change their route, there and then, and they ventured into the vast unknown. They went off the beaten track and headed down towards the coastline to slip silently past the spot where the Muslims were going to set up camp. And in this manner they slipped by, many kilometers away from their usual route, and slunk into Makkah like the cowardly rats that they were. They may have saved their goods, but their pride had taken a blow. The wind was knocked from their sails, and they had to admit that the Muslims were becoming a real and a serious thorn in their side. They could hardly consider their fleeing from the Muslims as a victory. So although they should have had a cause to rejoice with their lives and goods both being intact, the situation, however, was that their mood was dark and somber, as they faced up to the fact that the Muslims were not letting up and were only growing in strength and number, and that they would not be able to escape the Muslims forever. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, on the other hand, they returned with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to Medina, not having met up with the caravan of the Quraysh, but returning home with the knowledge that they had struck terror into the hearts of the mushrikeen that they knew, as well as those of the kuffar that they didn't know, but whom Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal knew. And in this manner, the second battle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to a close. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.